Glad that you're here again tonight. Welcome those who've joined us on live stream also. We'll be in the Gospel of John, the fourth chapter. This will be our 47th installment in this book. We're going to be covering verses 23 and 24. Now, it's good for us to associate whatever part of the scripture we're in, to associate it with the rest of scripture and with the day of salvation in particular. For instance, God is described as a very present help in the time of trouble. Man may not always be aware of this. Like the woman at the well, she wasn't aware of this. But we'll find that she does stand in need of help, and there was present help was present there. She said enough to reveal what was in her heart, so we know that in a sense she was a seeker, a very present help in the time of trouble. The woman didn't know it. If this is true, this assessment, that she didn't realize it, then we have an example here of someone who was found by Christ who didn't seek him. Now, this, of course, is a teaching of Scripture given by God himself. He said he would be found of them that sought him not. Isaiah 65:1, particularly applying to the Gentiles. That is, the finding of the people was a divine initiative. It wasn't a quest here or there. It was initiative there, here. Amen. Through Isaiah, God said, I said, behold me unto a nation that was not called by my name. See, God can and has done this.
Yes.
Well, that's what happened to the Gadarene demoniac. Isn't it? Christ found him. He wasn't seeking Christ. That happened to the widow of Nain. She wasn't seeking Christ. Christ found her. Raised her son from the dead. That Syrophoenician woman. Jesus went up the area where she was. She didn't come down where he was. He was found of them that sought him not. Jesus did say, I'm come to seek and to save that which is lost. So we've got examples in Scripture of Jesus seeking people out. Zacchaeus, he was found. He just wanted a look. He got more than a look. Jesus found him. There are statements of divine initiative now. Divine initiative. We're talking about divine initiative. The Lord is nigh them who are of a broken heart. Now, those of broken heart, they may not know this, but this is the way it is.
Amen.
The Lord is nigh unto them that call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. See, they may seem like he's way off. God's given an index to his character. This nearness isn't always perceived. It's preferable that it be, but truth is, it isn't always perceived. There are people that really don't need you to tell them. About the time you think people need you to tell them, you're just off on the wrong foot. You're just off on the wrong foot altogether. Jesus can be found to them that aren't seeking him. That's what he said. That's what he does. That doesn't mean you're not ever involved at all. I'm just saying there are instances where this isn't the case. Now, this nearness is near unto them of a broken heart. It's nigh unto them that call upon me in truth. This nearness is not always perceived, but it can always be believed. You may not sense it. May not feel like it. You can believe it. You can believe that this is the truth. particularly when you're living in a time and a place where there's a lot of offsetting allurements, troubling care, debilitating fear. It's all around. See, and it tends to neutralize a person's perception of the fact that God is, there is no place where God isn't. So perceiving this divine manner will be a great comfort to you. If you're full of confidence tonight, God be praised. If you're not, God be praised. Because he knows your heart and he'll act accordingly. Act accordingly to lift you up.
I actually experienced this. Now, I didn't know. I was discontent. I knew there had to be more.
Yeah.
And yet I wasn't seeking in the sense that, but he found yeah, where I was at.
Wasn't intelligent seeking, yeah. I know. Yeah. What you mean? City of Nineveh? Huh?
Yeah, that's
right. City of Nineveh, they weren't seeking.
Yeah.
God sent him a prophet, spirit of the city. So he'll often take the initiative, lead you into a broader perspective. He is the great shepherd of the sheep.
Yes, amen.
Yeah. We're in verses 23 and 24 in the midst of Jesus having a dialogue with the woman at the well of Samaria. He just got through telling her, you Samaritans don't know what you're worshiping. We know what we worship, salvation's of the Jews. But the hour cometh and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. Now, I think if you think the woman understood that, well, you just aren't thinking straight. There are a lot of people been in Christ a long time but don't understand it still.
Amen.
This is Christ's manner.
Yes.
He'll talk over your head, so you got to reach up. You got to look up.
Yes.
You got to feel after. See, that's the way Christ is.
Yeah.
This is the profound utterance given to a Samaritan woman.
Yeah.
And there are some theologians that have wrestled for years with this text, with this saying. Now, when Jesus entered into the world, he was fully aware of the times, and they were some times. The world was kind of at a low moral and spiritual time. Even the Jews, they were at a low, low state. It wasn't an ideal time. See, people think if you can create an ideal time, God will come.
Yeah.
People think this. But this isn't how it's happened. Historically, this isn't how it happened. Moses didn't come at an ideal time. Abraham didn't come at an ideal time. John the Baptist didn't come at an ideal time. But he came at the appointed time. There were a few people who were sensing that something was near. Like Nathanael, he was living in expectation. We found him whom the scriptures, he knew, the scriptures told about somebody. Whoa, we found him. And Joseph of Arimathea, he was waiting for the kingdom of God. See, but these were exceptional. These were exceptional people.
Yeah.
I've met people today that are exceptional people, like, I sense this myself, that we're on the border of something that's going to shake the religious world down. Something's going to happen, just going to, it's a lot of things going to become defunct. Because they haven't been working, see? People are hesitant to acknowledge this. But that we've got a form without power. But I know God isn't going to let this continue without interruption.
Yeah.
He told his disciples, he said, that the times and seasons are in God's power. And they are. He said, the hour is coming. Not the day, not the year. The hour is coming. A distinct and relatively instant period of time is about to arrive, Jesus said. It's coming. It's coming. Divinely set time. The time has been set. A time when in the history of the world, God would just intrude right into history. Just intrude and change the status of everything. See? That's God for you. Good to ask God to break through. I know you do this, breakthrough. We've been trying. We can't, don't seem to be able to get through. Abraham's son Isaac was born at a, quote, set time. The angel appeared to him and said, at this set time, next year. I'm showing that God governs things. God plans things for happen exactly at the time he intends them to happen. The plagues God sent upon Egypt, Exodus 9:5, so we're at a set time, a time God set. Israel was delivered at an appointed time. Here's how it's described. It came to pass at the end of 430 years, even the selfsame day. It came to pass that all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. That's remarkable, isn't it? Self same day.
That's right.
Not predicted, appointed.
That's right.
Now, there's a difference between predict and appoint. There's a difference between knowing ahead of time, prescience, and appointing.
That's right. Amen.
Known unto God are all his works. Mm-hmm. Of course, he knows man's works, but man's works don't determine what he does.
Right.
His purpose determines what he's going to do.
Amen.
And he gives you some examples of it. He has also appointed a day in which he's going to judge the world in righteousness. See? It's an appointed day. He hasn't told us when it is, but it's appointed, which means there's no chance that it'll just pass by, or that it'll be ignored, or that something will happen on earth that will delay it. It's not possible. So when Jesus said, the hour cometh, he was speaking of an appointed time that was standing at the door. Something was about to happen. A time for which men had to be ready. So John the Baptist came to get him ready for this time. Then Jesus come along, confirmed what John the Baptist said, and he moved him closer yet to the coming of it. This would be an hour, the hour cometh. This would be an hour when Satan would be defeated. Be an hour when principalities and powers would be plundered. It'd be an hour when there would be reconciliation made and sin would be taken away. Big hour. Big hour. You think of the holy men of God that waited for years for something like this. Bennett lived never one time seeing sin taken away. Seeing sin break out in Israel and stay in it for hundreds of years. Never was resolved. Now Jesus says, the hour is coming.
Yes, amen.
This whole thing is going to change. It's an hour when sin's not going to dominate my people anymore.
Yeah, amen.
I'm going to stop the reign of sin in my people. I'm going to stop it.
Yeah.
And they'll reign in life by one.
Yeah.
See, that's what the scripture says.
Amen.
See, where you see weak, failing, faltering, failing churches, see, something is wrong.
Yeah, amen.
He would announce the accepted time. There's some people search for God, didn't find him. But there's an accepted time.
Yeah.
When the faintest cry from the weakest heart be heard. In the heavenly chamber. And repentance and remission of sins would not be commanded, it'd be preached.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Preached repentance. See, you gotta, this then if you preach repentance, it's the repentance that's got to come from someplace other than men.
Yeah.
If you're just talking to men about repentance, you have to command them to repent.
Uh-huh.
But if God gives repentance and Christ gives repentance, then we preach.
Amen.
Because he has an hour coming.
Yeah.
The day of salvation. Now, very few people in the history of the world to this day have had even an introductory understanding of the impact sin has had on the human race.
Mm-hmm.
Alienated from the life of God. See, that's such a pregnant phrase. You've got to dwell on it for a while for it to see. Alienated means the life God has won't transfer to that person.
Yeah.
Alienated. Something's got to be done in the person before he can get life.
Amen.
Alienated from the life of God. Dead in trespasses and sin. See, this is the effect of sin.
Yeah.
You can get a religious pump and try and pump life into them. You know, it won't do it. It won't work. It won't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Only God can raise the dead.
Uh-huh.
But he can raise the dead.
Yeah.
Make no mistake about it. Jesus said, this hour is here.
Yeah.
This hour is coming.
Mm-hmm.
Men were able to, it doesn't mean that men weren't intelligent. They were very intelligent. Prior to this century, most of the great inventions, breakthrough inventions in math and philosophy and science and things like that, most of them were made prior to this century. They were all made a long time, some as far back as Noah. In 3000 BC, they were operating on eyeballs and had brain surgery in Egypt. I mean, it's... Men were able to come do a lot of things. Solomon said they sought out witty inventions. That's a very, very cunning. But nobody could come up with a way to defeat sin. Nobody could come up with a way to handle sin. All the philosophers of the world, you can have your Socrates and your Platos and all them. None of them could resolve the sin problem. But God did. Jesus announced in his hometown synagogue when he embarked on his ministry what he'd been sent to do. You remember these? He said he sent me to preach the gospel to the poor. To heal the hearts of the broken, to heal brokenhearted people. To preach or announce deliverance to the captives and the recovering of sight to the blind. To set at liberty them that are bruised and preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And he said, today, this is happening right here in Nazareth, right here in this synagogue, this is happening today.
Yeah.
The hour cometh. Then he adds, and now is. The Son of Righteousness had risen on the horizon of time, and the light was beginning to shine, and the day was beginning to dawn. It's already here, he said. That's what he announced in the Capernaum, in the Nazareth synagogue. Guess what he announced? It's here.
Yeah.
It's starting right now. I'll be honest with you. I don't like the people to tell me that it started back then and then it tapered off and changed and we're in Dullsville from now on. I don't buy into that. Even if they have convincing arguments, I won't believe them. I won't, will not believe them. Jesus started this thing. It can't be downhill at all. It can't be. Not what God's doing. Before Jesus commenced his mediatorial and intercessory ministry, he went about doing good and hitting all that were oppressed to the devil, for God was with him. So he did things that nobody else could do.
That's right. Yep.
God was working with him.
Uh-huh.
The kind of rule Jesus came to bring was a moral and a spiritual rule. He didn't come to relieve the poverty of the poor. Mm-hmm. That's what he had done. He had just liquidated poverty. That's not what he came to do. He didn't come to release them from Roman tyranny. That's not why he came. He would establish equity and execute judgment and righteousness. He would do this. But it was on a different plane.
Yeah,
amen. On a different plane. His visible miracles were a depiction of the kind of thing he was going to do.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
What Jesus came to do was miraculous in every sense of the word.
Yeah, amen. Yep.
So he demonstrated something that could not be done by anyone else.
Yeah.
They could not do it. He had blind men seeing, deaf men hearing, dumb men speaking, lame men leaping. That was something nobody else could do. He was introducing, this is the kind of work I'm going to do. No one else can do it.
Amen.
You can go to all the specialists, everyone that professes to help people with their behavior and so forth. They can't do what Jesus does. And if they say they can, they've lied.
Yeah.
Jesus will not share his glory with somebody else.
Amen.
He will not let somebody do what only he does.
Yeah, that's right.
There are things, brethren, that if you want them done, you're going to have them done by Christ.
Amen.
And he, like God, is a very present help in a time of trouble. So he's accessible. And then Jesus raised the dead also. He healed people with debilitating diseases like leprosy and impotency.
I think a lot of people would think in their mind, well, if Jesus was just here, then he could do it. But he is here.
He is here.
Yeah.
See, the people of God are intended to do a lot more than they're doing. Jesus said to his disciples, who were members of the church, the apostles weren't the heads of the church. They were members of the church. Yes. The first rank. Don't make no mistake about it. He said first, but he set them in the church, not apart from the church. He said, the works that I do shall you do. Now, I remember when I had I kind of had to skirt that text because it contradicted my theology. It contradicted my theology, but then I became bold and I was able to accept what it said. So the works that I do shall ye do, and greater works, greater, this is what Jesus said, greater works shall ye do because I go to the Father. Now the day of Pentecost, Peter converted more people than Jesus did in 3 years. Why? Because Jesus can do more from heaven than from on earth.
Yes, amen.
He intends for the church to wield divine power with discretion. I understand.
Yeah.
But this is intended. And Jesus introduced this type of thing when he was on earth on all the miracles that he wrought. He was introducing this type of power to people.
Mm-hmm.
See, power was just theoretic.
Mm-hmm.
Much like it is today. It's just theoretic. People talk about power. They're just talking theoretic. You can't look at the average church and conclude it's powerful.
Yeah.
Something's wrong with someone if they think they can do this. It doesn't take divine power to fill a building.
That's right. Amen.
The Muslims are going to cram 8 million people in that court over there.
Yeah.
And have them all kneeling at the same time.
Right. Yeah.
See, this doesn't take divine power.
But
to bring a person to repentance and bring a person to seek God, bring a person with their discontent with sin, bring a person where they want to be right with God, that takes power.
Amen.
That's the kind of power now Jesus has himself, and he will give.
Yes.
Paul said he had power to edify. But edify means to build up, make stable.
Yeah.
So, well, I don't think a man can do that. Paul could do it.
Yeah.
Because he had the power to do it. There are people today that can do it too. Power. Jesus never confronted a person or a situation he was not in absolute control of.
Yeah.
He never did want, this is in his lowest state, huh? This is in his most humbled, weakened state. He never confronted any circumstance, any event, any personality that he did not absolutely and evidently dominate.
Yeah.
That's the devil, that's demons, that's storms, that's waves, whatever it was. The elements held him up when he walked on the water. See, that was in his weakened state. I mean, you only can imagine what he's doing now, what he can do now. So you have situations you think are pretty difficult, do you? We're talking about Christ here. So Jesus was never challenged by any situation. If you've got 5,000 men beside women and children, so all right, so you're probably talking 20, 25,000 people, and they need to be fed. This is no problem with Jesus. It was a problem with the disciples. Just give them something to eat. He said, man, we can come up with is 5 loaves and 2 fishes. I mean, and we only got 200 penny worth. That's not, we can't buy enough bread. What are we going to do? He said, well, what is that you say you have? You found a lad, 5 loaves and 2 fishes? Make the people sit down.
That's right.
See, that's how Jesus is.
Yeah.
There'll be times when we come into this room, it'll seem like we don't have much.
Uh-huh. Yep.
But you can get Jesus in among us. He says, if 2 or more of you gather together in my name, I'm there.
Yeah.
If you can get Jesus among us, that changes the whole, the whole picture, and they'll all be fed.
Yeah. Amen.
All right, Jesus told the woman, the hour's cometh and now is.
Yeah.
Yes.
We have the saying for men who do a lot of talking but not a lot of doing. The people who are like that, we say they're all talk. They say, we're going to do this and we're going to do this and this, that, and the other. You know, they have a list of things and they never do it.
Uh-huh.
It's all talk.
Yeah.
Well, when God talks, it's called the living word of God.
Living word,
that's
yeah.
living and active, and it accomplishes that which he set forth to do.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're being exposed to the word of God, then that's the kind of talk you want to be listening to and submitting to.
See, all things are possible to him that believes.
Yes.
It's still true.
That's right.
If you can believe, Jesus said, said to that father, that oppressed son, son falling on the ground, wallowing, Jesus says to him, how long has he been done? How long has this been happening? Well, says it's been since he was a lad, since a boy, kids wallowing on the ground. Just since he's a boy, sometimes it's, demon throws him in the fire, throws him in the water. He said, if you can do anything, help us.
Amen.
Jesus took the ball and pitched it right back.
Yeah, that's right.
Said, the question isn't if I can do anything. If you can believe, all things are possible in the beliefs. He says, I believe.
Yeah.
He said, help my, he knew, he, it was like he had a short arm. He couldn't, couldn't reach far enough. He said, help my unbelief, and Jesus did.
Yes, amen.
Jesus did. The hour cometh, woman. I mean, there's still people talking about where do you worship and this sort of thing. Remember, that's what she had said. Our fathers say here in this mountain, Mount Gerizim, that's where you worship. And you Jews say in Jerusalem's where to worship. She didn't ask him which is the right place, but he knew that she wanted to know. Well, he says the hour is coming.
Yeah.
And now is. So we're, what you're talking about just about to become obsolete.
Yeah.
And believe me when I tell you, Jesus doesn't talk about things that are obsolete.
Yeah. Right.
If Jesus in his vicarious death and his resurrection solved the problem, he will not talk about it to you. You got to accept his solution.
Yeah, amen.
Not be talking about it.
Amen.
See, there are people dominated by sin, and the only reason they are is because they haven't accepted the divine solution.
Uh-huh.
So we're not going to give him ways to do what Jesus says he does. Tell them about him. The hour cometh. Now is when the true worshipers. The word worshipers occurs 6 times in the King James Bible. All the talk these days about worship, you think it'd be on every page. Well, it isn't. 9 times in the New King James Bible. 9 times. 10 times in the New American Standard Bible. You notice the more modern versions use this word more. And the New International Version has it 7, New International 7 times. Of all those references, most of them refer to worshiping Baal. Very few of them refer to worshiping God. That's just an interesting fact. I'm not drawing any conclusions yet. The Jews which were under the law is talking about, that mentions worshipers there when they, at the Day of Atonement, that the worshipers weren't purged of their guilt. It's meant just a passing reference. Well, let's investigate a little further what did we mean when we say worshiper. What do we mean? A worshiper is someone who displays devotion to the Lord, toward deity, pays homage to someone he confesses is superior to him. It occurs in someone who's living for the one they... If a person's living in sin and they tell you they're worshiping, they either just lied or they just don't understand. Because a person who's sinning can't worship God. God won't let him in. He's made provision now to settle that sin problem. Understand, he doesn't have to stay outside. He's made perfect, but when you come, you got to come with a true heart, and your body's washed with pure water, and your conscience purged from dead works. That's how you got to come.
Yeah, amen.
Hebrews 10:22 tells you that you don't get in if you don't come that way.
Yeah.
But there's a place there where you can get that cleaning up.
Yeah.
Done. Full provision is made for it. In our time, worship has been equated with singing. I don't know when this started, but it's here. But that's not the way it is in Scripture at all. That doesn't mean singing is never worship. That's not what I'm saying. I mean, worship is not always singing.
Yeah,
in fact, I would say that singing is one of the lower forms of worship. Because it's too periodic. It's not consistent and long enough to be constituted worship. See? I think, this is my own opinion, and I won't be contentious about it. I think Satan's invented this definition to ease people's conscience. Worship. Worship is not seasonal. It's not regional. It's not provincial. Worship is either all the time or it's not at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, when we come together, that's kind of a different... Uh-huh. We pool together, and it's a different kind of situation. But if you're not a worshiper when you come in here, you sure aren't going to become one while you're here.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Worshippers. The worshiper values and honors the one he worships. How do you know? He lives for him. The worshiper lives to please God.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jesus, we are told, gave himself for us that we might live unto him who died for us and rose again. That's why Jesus died.
Yeah.
So we could live.
That's, right.
That's all the time.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Live unto or toward. Live with him in mind.
Yeah.
That's why he lived and died. Mm-hmm. Died and rose again. That's why.
Mm-hmm.
So if a person isn't doing that, so far as he's concerned, at that point, Christ's death is vain for him.
Yeah.
And full provision is made to exit that condition. He's not, no one's locked in that condition unless God locked him there. Now, it says that the true worshipers, the true worshipers, the real ones. Some of the other versions, the Douay version says the true adorers. And worship does include the idea of adoring, adoration. Another version says real worshipers. By God's definition, it's real. Some say do obeisance, that is you humbly bow before the Lord. You say, do I do it physically? Well, it's probably good to do it physically once in a while. But you bow before you defer. If your will and God's will clashes, you defer to God's will.
Amen.
Defer to it.
Yes.
Say, well, I don't feel like it. We'll start feeling like
that's
it. Do it.
Yeah.
And if you, the day you feel some resistance in your own will, if you will extend yourself to do it, you'll be just like the lame man. He was lame, but when Peter said, pick up your bed, walk, stand up and walk, he extended himself, and when he extended himself, he got the power to do it.
Amen.
When you extend yourself to do what Jesus said, you'll get the power to do it. Yes, Brother Judah.
From this, that worship is submissive. This is all the time, like you brought out. That's something that I find frustrating in music, is it there has to, as if there's some sort of differentiation between a worship song and just any other song from a Christian artist. I don't really get that, because worship is...
Yeah, whatever that is.
Yeah. Right. But the thing is, with worship, like you said it pretty well, is that either you're doing it all the time or you're not doing it at all.
Yeah.
Worship is, you live it all the time, you never stop.
Yeah.
And it's submissive all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So if there's any ounce of self... or pride that is there, then it's going to have to be done away with if the worship is true, like you're talking about.
Yeah.
Submit yourself under the mighty hand of God. He giveth grace to the humble, but he resists the proud.
Mm-hmm.
This act of bowing that you brought up is a sign that you're submitting yourself to what's going on. In foreign countries, you bow to the king. It shows your submission to him.
Mm-hmm.
That's what this signifies, is we're submitting to the Lord.
That's right.
Yeah, worship is an intelligent
that's right.
thing. It's not, you know, I was listening to a man this week, and he was a Jewish Christian, but he was questioning these praise songs. He says, what, he let them sing. He let somebody sing this praise song, and then after he said, what was that all about? He said, let's think about this for a minute. He said, you just got done saying that, God, you're the air I breathe. He said, what does that mean? He was questioning. He said, where's that in the Bible? He said, where are you going to find it? He said, you think, I saw a bunch of you raise your hands. It's not wrong with raising your hands. Do you think that worship is that? Is that what you think worship is?
Yeah.
He was talking about this whole thing that it's an intelligent thing. It's something that you've seen something about God.
Yeah.
And
worship
you're expressing
it. It's discerning.
Worship is discerning.
Now, admittedly... Some of these people, they just don't understand. It's not, they're not trying to be belligerent. That's what they've been taught.
That's right.
See, the flawed spiritual conditions that exist are the direct result of who's been teaching that generation. Maybe someone they listened to on a TV or something, but they've been subjected to some form of religion that made them conclude what they've concluded.
We're talking about. I can remember singing this. I can remember that started when I was just a kid.
Oh yeah.
In the youth groups and things like this, singing little shallow songs. So it just has been coming on for a long time, and now we got this, what it's graduated to now. But I used to question them songs when we sang them.
You remember Paul? His father was a Pharisee, lived in Damascus, which is quite a little distance from Jerusalem, and his father and mother sent him to Jerusalem to the premier teacher in Jewry, Gamaliel. This was the premier doctor of the law, and he raised Paul up.
Yeah, that's right.
Samuel, as soon as he was weaned, his mother takes him to the tabernacle, and Eli, the aged priest, raised Samuel.
That's right.
It takes, in today's generation, it takes too long for children to become acquainted. Now, it's, most of the parents here, this isn't true of you because you've learned. But see, a lot of people, they don't really know. They don't know this. They really don't know this. And so as a result, they've lost their children by the time they're 10.
Yeah.
They've cultured stubbornness and selfishness. And you want that to... Anyway, I won't go any further about that. But
to be judgmental. I don't think we should be judgmental in that sense.
Yeah.
I think we need to be careful what we buy into.
You're absolutely right. See, if you express simple stuff all the time, you'll be a simpleton.
Yeah.
That's just what happens. That you're not trying to be, but that's your mind has to be used for things that are higher than you presently are. You've got to reach higher than you are now. If you sent your child to school and in the fifth grade they were still reciting the ABCs, you'd say, hey, you know, what's wrong here?
Uh-huh.
But that's exactly what's happening among professed Christians. They're still talking ABC.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Someone comment on that. You brought out how this worship's like an attitude that drives the heart. I wanted to think about that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
About like what kind of an attitude someone who worships God would have. Because if you think about that, someone whose mind is, the attitude we have is the mindset of a servant. It says that in Scripture.
That's right.
When you've been made free from sin, you become servants of righteousness.
That's
so
right.
We have these expressions like the will of the Lord be done. You see, that's like a mindset we live with that drives. Like God's will, not my own. That's like mindset of a servant. And not my will, thy be done. And it's also like, what will you have me to do, Lord? Like work, you know, like a servant. Like where's God directing me here? So it just got me thinking about that when you said it's an attitude.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah, that's something that's seen.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a mindset. Mm-hmm. It can't be bottled up. See, worship can't be bottled up.
Yeah.
It breaks forth toward God and
in
praise, thanksgiving, and petitions, dependency. There's just a lot of ways. Now, true worshipers. The Israelites worshiped God, but it was kind of from afar. They weren't what Jesus would call true worshipers. They could be delivered in one night. 3-4 million people in one night at midnight.
Yeah, that's right.
They could be delivered from Egypt. Not a hoof was left behind and not a dog barked at them.
Yeah.
And the Egyptians paid them all their back wages. They could do that. Cross the Red Sea, see their enemies washed up on it, and go a couple miles down the road and start griping.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, they weren't true worshipers. Because law can't teach you to worship.
Yeah, that's right.
You can't teach a person to worship.
Yeah.
Go through. Bow down here, stand up there, so forth. Some, like Catholicism, they teach people how to worship.
Yeah.
Your routine. But true worshipers, that's not the way they do.
Mm-hmm.
That's not even how they are.
Yeah.
Yes?
So even like if someone does the things that we might outwardly think is true worship, they still may not be a true worshiper.
That's right.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
It can't be a routine.
Yeah.
So I've... had several discussions with people about what they call the mechanical instrument. And the last debate I had on that, I said, well, there's no such thing as a mechanical instrument. Unless there's an instrument that plays by itself. A radio is a mechanical instrument. I said, the thing that concerns me is mechanical worship. That's what the Jews had.
Uh-huh.
Mechanical worship. That's what they had. And their heart wasn't in it, see? It couldn't be in it. Yes?
There were generations who got beyond that. Like that generation of Nehemiah who stood in the rain and worshiped and wept at the reading of the Word of God. Now, those people, Those yeah, people, their hearts were in that.
Yeah, most of them were loners, though. See?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They weren't in mass. There was, 56,000, something like that, joined them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there have always been worshipers. There have always been worshipers, but they've been few and far between until this hour.
Yeah, that's right.
Till this hour that Jesus announced, and that's going to change the whole thing. It's going to change.
Amen.
You know, Paul wrote to the Philippians and said, "Now we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit." And he didn't say we are the circumcision which should worship. Uh-huh. We ought to worship. We must worship. He said, "We do." We do. We have the circumcision of which worship God.
Yeah.
In the spirit.
Yeah.
Your spirit, he's talking about, the human spirit.
Yeah.
Worship is inside and it's expressed outside.
Yeah.
See, worship can't be contained inside. It bursts like a flowing river out of your belly and it flows out.
Right.
See? Worship. The days of such worship as Israel had were about to become obsolete.
Yeah.
God is patient with it because there wasn't such a thing as a new birth. There was no such thing as justification, being born again, having atonement for sin, being made righteous. This didn't exist till sin was taken away. Sin had to be taken away. This hadn't happened, so God was long-suffering. Times of ignorance he winked at. But now, he's not winking anymore. Now he commands all men everywhere to repent. Doesn't make any difference where they are. See? The solution to sin is not reform.
Yeah, that's right.
It's repent.
Amen.
People got to see this now.
Yeah.
You say, well, how can that be? Because when you repent, God comes into the situation and enables the person to proceed on. But when he's not there, you got to repent today, repent tomorrow, and keep on being overcome by sin.
Yeah.
The hour is coming. They're going to worship the Father. The hour is coming when the true worshipers shall worship the Father. Do we worship Jesus? Yes. We worship Jesus, but we worship the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our worship is really directed at God through Christ.
That's right. Amen. That's right.
Other versions say worship the Father in spirit. Mm-hmm. Worship him in the true way of the Spirit. Now some of the versions here, in my judgment, missed the point, but I'll share with you what they say. Worship the Father spiritually. All right, that's in the true spiritual way. That's wrong. With true spiritual worship. That's pretty good. Being led by the Spirit to worship the Father. That's not what he's saying. We'll worship the Father as he really is. That's pretty good. Your worship must engage your spirit. That's pretty good. It's your spirit that he's talking about. Now the Holy Spirit is involved. I understand that. But it means in your spirit, which is the most profound part of your person. You're made up of, in order of preeminence, spirit, soul, body. Your spirit's the real you. That's where the born again is. Your soul, that's your rational and expressive part. That's the part of you that expresses, see? It has to be sanctified. Your soul can be up, it can be down, it can be in, it can be out, it can be sad, it can be glad. It vacillates. Your soul vacillates. Why art thou cast down, oh my soul? But your spirit isn't. It isn't that way in your flesh. It's just you got to get under your flesh and tote it around.
Yeah,
keep under your body and bring it into subjection. So worship in the spirit, you worship the deepest part. If you're at the deepest part, it affects all the other parts.
Mm-hmm.
If you start with a shallow part, it just fizzles out.
Yeah.
It can't drop. You can't worship in the flesh and it drop down into your spirit. This will not happen. It's got to start in your spirit. Come up through your rational, your thinking, and so forth, and then express through your mouth or however. Your life is to be a life of worship. Your living sacrifice is worship. That's what it is. Living for God. In view of saying that when you worship, you are moved by the Spirit to worship, I think that that view dilutes the text. I don't think it's possible for a person in their spirit to earnestly desire to worship God where the Holy Spirit wouldn't come alongside. But the Holy Spirit doesn't come alongside to produce the feeling. That's not why he comes. He comes to sanctify it and enable you to do what you want to do.
Romans 12, now yeah, you think it's the same worship. Kind of spiritual.
That's right. It's within. Mm-hmm. See, all of the worship of the Jews was external. The law didn't require faith. There was no commandment under the law to believe. The law is not of faith. Galatians 3:12. But in Christ, when you believe, then all these other things begin to happen. Brother Jason?
To understand the meaning of spirit and truth there, it helps to understand what the woman asked Jesus just before this. She said, "Shall we worship on this mountain or that mountain?"
That's right.
That was the question. And Jesus said neither.
Neither. Mm-hmm.
What he's pointing out here is that kind of worship that was going on in Jerusalem at that time and on Mount Gerizim, that wasn't really worship.
Amen.
In contrast to that, Jesus said, the true worshipers will worship in spirit and in truth.
Yeah.
Amen.
So whatever they were doing in Jerusalem, in the temple, and in Mount Gerizim, that wasn't the real thing that God was after.
Mm-hmm. See, God was tolerant of that until redemption.
Yeah.
Right? Until redemption, he forbore that type of, but he's not forbearing of lifeless religion anymore.
That's right.
Whoever has got to get out of it.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And all the resources now you need
have
been supplied in Christ Jesus. Mm-hmm. They shall worship the Father in spirit, that is from within. The part of you that's born again, put it that way if you want to.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And in truth or reality.
Yeah.
No pretension. Not an organized human procedure. You really adore the Lord.
Yeah.
You love him, you lean on him, you prefer him. Yes, Sister June.
That in spirit and in truth, that truth does have to do with the revelation that God has given of himself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can't make up something else and expect it to bring you to God.
Mm-hmm.
All of it proceeds from God. The revelation proceeds from him. The power proceeds from him. The provision proceeds from him. Everything, salvation, is of the Lord.
Yeah.
So that in truth, of course, the things that God has said and has revealed to us, they are real. But the truth is a little bit bigger than just being restricted to a reality that we can perceive.
Mm-hmm.
It has to do with that faith in what he has said also.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
amen.
Amen. No matter where you are in Christ or how long you've been in Christ, if you lift up your eyes and look, there's more to be seen. You'll know that. Well, I'm sure not there yet.
Yeah.
Yes, Brother Jason.
I think the point of this, of these phrases, in spirit and truth, he's talking about what's going on in the person.
Mm-hmm.
He's not talking about something external.
Amen.
He's not talking about a kind of worship.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
He's talking about a kind of worshiper.
He worships. Yeah.
Now, if the person is set right, the worship will be acceptable.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
Uh-huh.
But if the person's not right, it doesn't matter what they do.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not going to be acceptable. So this,
that's right.
I've heard this interpreted in all different kinds of ways.
I know. Mm-hmm.
But I don't think it has anything to do with what is done, per se. Mm-hmm. It has to do with the kind of person.
That's right.
That's why I don't think this translation, spiritual worship,
That, see,
I don't know what it means.
That misleads you. That's, I'm not saying it's completely wrong, but it's it's misleading. It's like it's something external.
Well,
see, like it's something I do. That's not what he's talking about here. It's the person that matters, and when the person is right, then what the person does is going to be right.
Yeah, that's right.
This, the lady asked him about worship, and he told her about worshipers.
That's right.
It says spirit and truth, not spirit or truth.
That's right.
That's right.
I mean, it comes together. That spirit, and you touched on it earlier, that you said it was the deep, it's the fountainhead of what we are.
Yes.
It defines everything else about us. You are either dead in trespasses and sins, or you're alive to God in Christ Jesus. Yeah. It has to do with life.
Amen.
Too.
That's
and
right.
Spirit and truth are like Siamese twins. They always travel together. You can't worship in spirit and in a lie. You can't have the truth and it not affect your spirit. Truth makes you free. See, so these travel, these are paired together.
Example of that would be Cain and Abel.
Yeah, that's right.
Abel was, his sacrifice was accepted because of who
he did it.
You know, going back to Romans again, now Paul expounds that a little bit. And he equates a living sacrifice.
Living sacrifice.
With your spiritual,
your
worship.
It's a sacrifice of life.
That's right. Yes, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah, the sacrifice that they offered were dead. Yeah, they had to kill them before they offered them. And then he has the Father seek such to worship him. Yeah. So God's on the lookout.
Yeah.
Remember this word in 2 Chronicles 16:9 said, the eyes of the Lord run. Now see, the devil, he's walking. Is what it says?
Yeah, it's
the devil walking.
Yeah.
To and fro, seeking him and may devour. But the eyes of the Lord run to and fro, looking for a man whom he can show himself strong in behalf of him. In other words, God's looking for somebody who has a cause he can undergird. It's doing something that requires his strength.
Right.
See? He won't miss him.
Amen.
He will not miss him. Yes.
Yeah, not to keep beating this horse to death, but that last phrase again undergirds the fact that he's talking about the worshiper.
Uh-huh. You're absolutely
not,
right.
Now, I'm not saying that the worship itself isn't in view here as well, but again, when he says the Father seeketh such that refers to the worshiper, the person. In other words, God is not just looking for a certain kind of worship.
He's
looking for a certain kind of worshiper.
Yeah.
Now it just stands to reason that a certain kind of worshiper will offer a certain kind of worship that is acceptable to God. But you can't get that cart before that horse, or you'll be right back into religion, this dead religion.
Yeah.
He's also talking there about the work that he's going to accomplish. Because we have people, we have the example of people like Daniel and David and Abel. You know, they had a desire Godward.
Yeah.
If we were to put them in the new covenant, they would excel in these things. But when Jesus came, he's talking about the work he would do, what he would make us.
That's right. That's right. That's what he's telling this woman.
Yeah.
He's giving her a glimpse of what's coming, what he's going to affect. He's going to put in motion something that's going to alter the whole religious landscape.
Yeah, yeah. Amen.
See? There are major denominations that have not seen this. Catholicism and Presbyterianism both teach that the New Covenant is an extension and has been appended to the Old Covenant. This is their doctrine. This is what they teach. But that's not what's happened at all.
Amen.
It was a schoolmaster. The law was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. And when you come to Christ, no more schoolmaster.
Amen.
Yeah. Father seeketh such, as Brother Jason pointed out, that's people. That's who he's looking for. There was a man named Cornelius. He was one of these. He was one of these. And the Lord found him and sent his angel down there and said, listen, we've heard your prayers up here, and we've received your offerings up here. He wasn't a Christian. He wasn't a Christian.
Right.
But he's about to become one.
Yes,
see?
Amen.
He was found.
That's right.
Yes, but,
amen.
Living sacrifice is a life that keeps sacrificing over.
Good. Mm-hmm. Good.
And so it's a the sacrifice is the whole life.
Yes,
it's not just given once.
Amen.
And it's a sacrifice that wants to be given.
Yeah.
And we so often hear a comment about that text that the problem with the living sacrifice is that it keeps crawling off the altar.
Yeah.
Actually, that kind of life never got on the altar.
That's right.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Well, there, someone started that saying and people just repeated it, but it's a dumb saying no matter. Yes, Brother Jason.
See, God doesn't want, he doesn't just want worship.
Yeah.
He doesn't want something from us.
Mm-hmm.
He wants us.
Yeah.
Amen. And this is what separates God from all the pagan gods.
Yes.
Amen.
God doesn't just want us to get together and,
amen.
And worship.
Yeah.
He wants us.
Yeah.
Amen.
All the time.
Mm-hmm.
All
amen.
Of us. All the time. See,
mm-hmm.
this is completely different than like pacifying an angry God. This
mm-hmm.
all the old pagan religions.
Yeah.
You would pacify the God. The
yeah.
God's angry, so you bring him something.
Yeah.
And then he's not mad at you anymore, and he leaves you alone.
Yeah.
See, that's not the God of the Bible.
No.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
Then he continued. Now, remember, I doubt that this woman understood to any significant degree hardly anything Jesus said. But I have an idea on the way back to town that some of this stuff was opened up to her.
Yeah.
That's how Jesus works. He deposits a pretty good amount of truth in your heart.
Mm-hmm.
And the Holy Spirit's over here, and he says,
yes.
go to work on that now and open that up to him. That's how it works.
That's right.
Jesus told the two on the road to Emmaus, he told them a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Finally began, it sunk in finally. That's
yeah.
the way Jesus is. He feeds it to you, then all of a sudden, the day dawns, the day star rises in your heart. Now he continues, God is a spirit. Now I don't like that translation, a spirit. The article's not in there. I'm not going to be contentious about it, but that implies that there are other spirits. And there are other spirits, but that's not like God. So God is spirit, that's how I prefer it. Some versions say he's a spiritual being, he's God is sheer being itself, spirit. That's the Message Bible. I don't know what the fellow meant when he said that, but that's what he said. As spirit, God stands apart from every form
yeah.
of limitation.
Yeah, right.
You got to see that. He's not limited by time, space, form, and God is spirit, totally, without any limitation whatsoever.
Amen.
Look at that viewed from another viewpoint. Omnipotent would be kind of the positive way of seeing it. Now, there are three places in Scripture where it tells us what God is, three different times. John said God is light, 1 John 1:5. 1 John 4:8 says God is love. Here in this text says God is spirit.
Uh-huh.
So let's take a brief look at these.
Mm-hmm.
By saying God is light, he means all light, illumination, comes from him.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
He's just, God is light. He's a source.
Yeah.
Here, here's an example, both in the natural and the spiritual.
Yeah.
God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, there's the creation,
yeah.
has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of God in the face of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So as the light,
yeah.
he generates light
Amen.
And bestows light on others. God is love. And as he's the source of all genuine love. Beloved, let us not love one another, for love is of God. See, there it is. He's the one. He's the source.
Amen.
You can't teach somebody to love. You can tell them about it, but God's the one that can teach them. He's love. It all comes from him. And then God is a spirit. He's the source of all other spirits. They all came from him. We read this in Hebrews 12:9. We have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much more rather be in subjection to the Father of spirits? See? So I read what God is. Don't think of it just theoretically. Mm-hmm. Whatever God is, he can transmit in measure. Understand? He can transmit in measure to someone else.
Yeah. Amen.
That's good to ponder.
Yes.
They that worship him. Now here's a class. This is the class of people. Separate from all other people. They that worship him. See, that's not they that should worship him, they that ought to worship him. They that worship him. Those who have been separated from other people are described as, we are they that worship God in the Spirit. Philippians 3:3. There's other gods in the world. Is written, for though there be many that are called gods, and some of these are called Jesus, and everybody understands this, I trust. Whether they be in heaven or in earth, as there be gods many and lords many, but to us, those that worship God, to us, there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we say from whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. So when it comes to a choice, we got to make a choice. We defer. The default is God. That's the default. And if you live by faith, now listen, you can try and do this by discipline and routine and self-government, or you can do this by faith. If you do it by faith, God will enable you to default. You may be weak. Maybe you've been through a tremendous trial and you're very weak. God will enable you to choose God and to reject the false way. You try to do this by a routine and you'll fall flat on your face. There'll come a time when you just don't feel like doing the routine. I thank God it's this way now. They that worship him. Must. Well, people don't like that word. In a free country, wherever we have our rights, you know, and this sort of thing. They must. Well, let's look at the word. Is it a strong word? Well, it is a strong word. Here's what it means. Necessary. There's need of it. It behooves. Is right or proper. That which must necessarily take place is binding on one to do a thing. One must, one ought. Now, I tell you, when you ponder worship and you read something like this, you are not given the luxury of being in error.
Yeah, that's right.
When God says must, he doesn't accept anything else.
Yeah.
I understand that there are some people been taught otherwise. I know that. But see, God's going to deal with those teachers, and he's not going to be gentle.
Yeah, right.
He said, if any man defiles this temple, God went on record. 1 Corinthians 3, he went on record. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. Now, God's serious. He means this.
Right.
He means this. If he gets some garbage in the building, wood, hay, stubble, that's not talking about your deeds. That's talking about people.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
says, if anyone puts that in the church, and somebody has done this. We got churches full of wood, hay, and stubble. Somebody did that. If they don't repent, I don't know if they can repent. I don't know if you can do something like that and repent. I hope so. But if they don't come away from that, God's going to destroy them. Why? Because they presented another worker other than God. They must worship him in spirit. Now here we come back to closing with this again. Some versions say the way of the Spirit. I don't think that's what he's talking about here. It's in the human spirit. That's the deepest, most profound part of your person. Spirit in order of priority. Spirit, soul, body. It's from the top down. Spirit, soul, body. Your worship can't just be from your body. Right? Some people just bodily. That's the way they do it. Some people from their soul. It's kind of emotional and touch their feelings, and that's the extent of it. But it's got to be in your spirit. It's got to originate in your spirit. And then that will sanctify the rest of you. So your emotions will be proper. Your bodily actions will be appropriate. You're free to do quite a bit. You can do a little bit of leaping if you want. Man, it was healed. He leaped in the temple, you know. You got something to leap about? We have no objection to you leaping. Just do it orderly.
That's right.
Aside from the teaching of my good father, I was raised up hearing that worship was according to the pattern set forth in the scripture. You heard that, Brother Tony?
Yeah.
Heard that all my life. Yeah. Worship according to the pattern. Now that's old covenant. That's Brother Moses.
Yeah, right.
They had a pattern because they didn't have any life. You got to have a pattern where you don't have life.
Yeah.
And right, frankly, you can't take spiritual life and stick it in a box. It won't work because spiritual life advances and grows.
Yeah.
Worship in truth is worship that's in accord with your spirit, and it's in accord with God.
Yeah.
It's intelligent worship as well as it's emotional too.
Yeah.
But it's intelligent and emotional. Worshiping God in the spirit involves your whole person.
Yeah.
And in truth means in reality.
Mm-hmm.
In reality, this is really you. You can't like worship on the Lord's Day and go out and give your life to the devil and self-indulgence. You didn't worship. It was just a condemning exercise. See? So that's that worshiping in truth is harmonious with God himself, and it's your spirit. See, thou, if you have a congregation of people, and some of them can do this and some of them don't. See, it complicates things.
Yeah.
It complicates things. And invariably, someone's going to rise up and compromise in favor of the weaker.
Yeah.
That's the strategy.
Yeah.
But this should not be done.
Yeah.
A high level should be maintained so that the weaker are provoked to come up.
Yeah.
Come up higher into speed. Don't linger down there in the lowlands.
Yeah.
Don't do that. That's what this will do. If the people of God will live where they're supposed to live, there are people who will see it and want it.
Yeah, amen. That's right.
Amen.
I think I'm going to have to stop there. Any of you have something you'd like to add tonight? Yes, Brother Jason.
Some thoughts on God as spirit. Spirit as opposed to something material, fleshly, or something that you can see or touch. That's the contrast. So
if that's true, so there's a higher reality, in other words. There's more to reality than what you can touch or see or what is material. So,
praise God.
So if that's true of God, then that's also true of the worship of God.
Yes. Amen.
So there's more to worship than what you can see or touch. And let's see, Jesus is making this contrast between the worship that was going on in the temple in Jerusalem and on Mount Gerizim.
Mm-hmm.
Those were real places, but they were material, earthly places that could be touched.
Mm-hmm.
See, and Jesus is saying there's more to God than what is in the temple.
Yeah, see.
Because God is spirit. He's not located just... there's more. God's beyond a temple. He doesn't live in temples made with hands, Paul said, in Athens there. So there has to be more to worship. It doesn't mean we don't get together and sing, and there are things we do, but there's more to it than that. See, Jesus, that's what he's referring to here.
Yeah, it's like otherwise it's like a body without a spirit.
Yeah, that's right.
Even Solomon knew that truth.
Yeah.
So that had been revealed to Israel generations before. Yeah. They just rejected it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, Judy. Mm-hmm. Oh, with that age, excuse me.
In our reconciliation to him is in Christ, who is not 100% spirit flesh. For he was born under the law in our place to reconcile us to the Father.
That's right.
So we need to all point to Jesus who came in flesh, the God in flesh, the amazing one and only Messiah, who now reconciles us to the Father in spirit.
Mm-hmm. He's able to be touched with the feeling of where I'm
going. Amen.
See, he trafficked here.
Yeah.
He traveled here so he can give his people what they need.
That's
and do
right.
It
amen.
Amen.
When
men are the ones working, habit and routine can be changed, but not character. Men can't change character.
That's
right. They can change acts outward.
Yeah.
They can change the way you do things. Maybe they can change what you do.
Mm-hmm.
But they can't change the essence of what makes you do those things. That's why the law was not effective in making men righteous, because it changed the outward doing, but not the heart. It didn't change the mind. So now, what God has done, it's cut to the root. He's changed us.
Yeah.
We have a new heart and a new mind. We are a new man.
Yeah.
So now, as opposed to what pagan gods required as acts of worship, God has our very being, and as a result, worship is what happens.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
So it goes deeper than what it might seem. Instead of rendering a certain act to the deity in worship, you surrender yourself to God.
Mm-hmm. Living and sacrifice.
Then, yes, you surrender yourself to God, and then as a result, this outward worship is what happens.
Yeah. Amen. When I was young and started serving the Lord, I was, I think, 16, something like that. I used to work in Pacific Garden Mission in Chicago with people that were, they were vagrants and poor people, but there was an enormous amount of drunks. I never talked to a drunk that would admit they were a drunk. And it was, I didn't know then what I know now. I'd have had more to give, I guess. But it was in a sense, it was frustrating, because I sensed if folk don't know what they are, how are they going to call out on the name of the Lord? But some people were very successful in that. They knew how to, but I remembered, I just didn't realize that that kind of person existed. I'm very aware of it now.
Yeah.
Very aware.
Amen.
All right, Sister Barb will take our prayer.